Thank you to Novium for supporting PBS. What does an electron really look like? I mean, if we zoom in all the way, is it a sizeless speck of charge, or is it a multidimensional vortex of quantum strangeness? Is it the boundary of a tiny universe with universe electrons of its own? Let's find out. There isn't much that's simpler than the electron. It's one of the elementary particles, something not made of smaller things, at least according to the current theory. It conjures to mind a single point or perhaps a tiny ball made of some electric charge and mass and not much else. Like in the cartoon description of the atom with electrons as orbiting balls. But if you've paid attention to good pop-sci media, you probably know that these pictures aren't accurate. Perhaps you know that in quantum mechanics, particles exist not as tiny nuggets of matter, but rather as wave functions, fuzzy distributions that define the probability of where or what the particle might be when measured. For example, electrons in atoms are more accurately depicted as blurred shells than as orbiting balls. And a free electron might look like an undulating wave packet capable of interfering with itself and doing other wave-like things. But are these wave functions really what an electron looks like? These wavy structures seem more intuitive for something like the photon, which is literally a wave in the electromagnetic field, and whose most important properties like frequency and wavelength can be captured in wavy terms. But an electron has mass, it has electric charge, it has spin. Where do these properties live in a fuzzy wave function? There are valiant efforts to represent the non-spatial components of the electron wave function, in particular the spin or wave function, which we talk about here, but these are attempts to visualize a pretty abstract concept, not really what the electron looks like. So let's take a look. Let's really zoom in. We can never actually see a fuzzy wave packet because the electron takes on precise properties when we measure it. Looking at the electron means resolving its location and spatial structure. As we measure more precisely, the wave function shrinks to something particle-like. But how far can we zoom? Do we eventually see a tiny ball or an infinitesimal speck of charge and mass? And where does that charge and mass live? What does an electron really look like up close? There's an agenda behind this thought experiment. The very act of zooming in to see what an electron looks like will reveal some vexing contradictions, for example, about why the electron has the properties that it has. These contradictions foreshadow one of the biggest problems in physics today. But that's for future episodes. Today, we're just looking at the electron. Let's try constructing an electron first, using classical physics. We'll do that by gathering enough electric charge from the surrounding universe and sticking it together. Like charge repels via the Coulomb force, and Coulomb's law tells us that the closer we want to drag two bits of charge, the more force it takes. That means it takes more energy to assemble a more compact ball of charge than it does a more diffuse one, assuming the same amount of charge. A bit of calculus gives us the energy needed to assemble a ball of any given radius. And this is the potential energy that that ball holds after assembled. The smaller the ball, the more energy. From Einstein's relativity, we know that bound energy is equivalent to mass, E equals mc squared. So now we can ask the question, if we drag in one electron worth of electric charge until it's in a small enough ball that its potential energy is equal to the known mass of the electron, how big would that ball be? Well, around 2.8 by 10 to the power of minus 15 meters. This is the classical electron radius. It's the size an electron would have to be if its mass was all from the potential energy of its contained charge. But it's not the real size of the electron. Our experiments tell us that the true size of the electron is smaller than 10 to the power minus 17 meters, at least 100 times smaller than the classical electron radius. But if we continue to crush our ball of charge down to that size, the mass equivalence of that potential energy is 10 gigaelectron volts, which is 20,000 1,000 times larger than the actual measured electron mass of 511 kiloelectron volts. And if our electron really is point-like, having no size, then Coulomb's law gets a zero in the denominator, and the energy summed all the way to that central point is infinite. Now, the electron isn't really a ball of electric charge mutually repelling itself. Its charge does self-interact in complex ways, manifested in the activity of quantum fields surrounding the electron, as we'll see, but the equations and numbers I came up with do still give the energy contained in the electromagnetic field that emanates from a bundle of charge of the same size. And so this energy does still contribute to the electron's observed mass. This issue of the electron's electric field containing vastly more mass than the electron itself is, or at least was, a real problem, and one that persists even when we switch from classical to quantum mechanics. But for now, we get back to the electron. What does our zoom-in look like when we switch to quantum mechanics, or more precisely, quantum field theory? In QFT, we describe electromagnetism in terms of the activity of a quantum field. And each elementary particle is an excitation in its own quantum field, so the photon is an excitation of the EM field, and the electron and positron are excitations of the electron field. Quantum fields are sometimes described as these roiling oceans of virtual particles appearing and vanishing. This isn't very accurate. Instead, think of a quantum field as having the potential for complex and random fluctuations when it encounters a real particle. Those fluctuations can be modeled using virtual particles as a mathematical tool. We can model the Coulomb force in terms of virtual photons in the EM field imparting momentum between charged particles. Or we can model the spontaneous transfer of energy between the EM and electron fields in terms of a virtual photon turning into virtual matter-antimatter pairs. Pair production. In this case, a virtual electron and positron. So if the EM field in quantum field theory is an ocean of virtual photons, at least mathematically, what does that look like? Well, viewed from afar, the activity of these virtual photons is averaged over into the smooth field described by classical electromagnetism. But as our zoom in reaches a certain point, around 100 times larger than the classical electron radius, we transition to a regime where we can't ignore the quantum behavior of the field. For example, as the field strengthens and our view narrows, we see that the interaction between the EM and electron fields strengthens. We can describe this as an increase in the rate of pair production, an increasingly active flickering of virtual photons and the virtual electron-positron pairs that they spawn. This cloud of activity appears to grow stronger the closer we get to the electron. It's not just that we're seeing the quantum properties of the stronger EM field. The very act of probing the electron this closely amplifies quantum fluctuations. The Heisenberg uncertainty principle tells us that precision in spatial or temporal measurement leads to larger uncertainty in momentum and energy, respectively. The more precise our snapshot of that electron, the more energetic quantum fluctuations we'll observe. We talk about this effect in more detail in this video, but the upshot is that the universe looks very different depending on the scale that it's probed, and so does the electron. Although somehow all scales knit together into a unified whole. We are now at very small scales, quite a bit smaller than the classical radius. Here, it's clear that the bare electron appears to be dressed in this cloud of virtual activity. This dressing is the source of our self-energy and the extra mass from the electron's EM field. As we zoom ever closer to the electron, the energy in the field approaches the rest mass of the electron, and a new interaction becomes important. Now, the virtual electron-positron pairs have a decent likelihood of directly interacting with the central real electron. Sometimes, a virtual positron will actually annihilate with the real electron, which then promotes its once virtual partner electron to reality. It's as though the original electron shifted position. There are two important implications to this effect. One is that this effect actually rescues the electron from having the colossal or even infinite mass predicted by classical physics. More on that next time. Unfortunately, the second implication of this self-annihilation interaction is that we're never actually going to get a clear view of the electron, no matter how far we zoom in. The closer we zoom, the stronger the surrounding cloud of virtual fluctuations, but also the more frequent these interactions become. At some point, the electron becomes this flickering blur that we could never quite fix the location of. The mass ends up smeared out, both by the self-energy mass and by what is ultimately Heisenberg uncertainty. The electron's charge is also smeared out by the latter, and also smeared by something that I haven't told you about yet. Even before we got close to the central electron, virtual electron-positron pairs were smearing out that charge. Those pairs interact with the ambient EM field, with the positrons tending to shift closer to the center, while virtual electrons shift further away. This so-called vacuum polarization happens all around the central electron and has the effect of screening the external universe from that central charge. In fact, the observed charge should appear to rise as we get closer to the center, past this screening. If you calculate the effect of charge screening all the way to the infinitesimal distances, that central charge has to be infinite. That means the central electron would need to have infinite charge itself to overcome that infinite charge screening. Of course, we now know that we can never probe the electron down to a perfectly localized point, so that infinity is probably meaningless. However, it is true that the strength of the electromagnetic force increases at extremely small distances when charge screening is overcome. Even though we can't catch our electron in our infinite zoom, the elusive particle is extremely well understood, at least mathematically. We even know how to rescue the electron from having its mass and charge explode due to its interaction with the surrounding quantum fields. Although, to understand that, we need a tool called renormalization, which we'll explore soon. And we'll also see how this tricky issue with the electron foreshadowed a much, much bigger conundrum in physics, the hierarchy problem. And we'll meet the particle that has yet to be rescued from this issue. But that is also another story. For now, let's admire the tiny electron, outwardly simple, but inwardly mercurial. And it's a strangeness that only compounds as we localize it in space-time. Thank you to Novium for supporting PBS. Inspired by space, the Novium Hopper Pen Interstellar is an otherworldly gift idea for yourself or the amazing people in your life. The Hopper Pen Interstellar is available in Space Black, Starlight Silver, Mars Magma, and Neptune Blue, and is refillable. The meteorite-embedded Space Black edition contains a subtle reminder that we here on Earth are truly part of a greater galactic whole. Each meteorite edition features a fragment of the Muonione Luster meteorite, confirmed by a stainless steel certificate. Landing in northern Scandinavia more than a million years ago, the Muonione Luster meteorite was formed inside a planetoid core and is estimated to be 4.56 billion years old, making it older than the Earth itself. If you want to give a gift, Novium has also introduced a 9-piece gift set, which includes the Novium dock, a display stand with gravitating illusion. Of course, if you or your special someone prefers a fountain pen, then there's also the Novium Future, which can be ordered as a fountain pen and rollerball 2-in-1, or just as a fountain pen. Feel free to use the links in the description below and get 10% off all hover pens with code PBS. There's international shipping for most countries, and orders are still available for delivery before the holidays. Hi everyone, it's that time of year again. We want to hear your thoughts and opinions on the PBS Digital Studio survey. Every year, the Spacetime fans have been the most active fan group on PBS Digital Studio's audience survey, which we and the rest of PBS Digital Studios use to help understand what you enjoy on YouTube and what you would want to see us make more of. You also get to vote on new show ideas. There's a link in the description. Thanks in advance. Hey everyone, before I go, I just wanted to let you know there will be 15% off the whole merch store for all of December. All of this year's merch, including limited edition items, are back in the store. So, if there's Spacetime merch you've thought of picking up for yourself or someone else in your constellation, now's a great time. Just head over to pbsspacetime.com/shop or click the links in the description.